Good morning and welcome. Isn't it good to be together on this special day? Let me begin our time of worship with a few verses from Psalm 95. O come, let us sing to the Lord. Let us make a joyful noise to the rock of our salvation. Let us come into his presence with thanksgiving. Let us make a joyful noise to him with a song of praise. For the Lord is a great God and a great King above all gods.
Thank you. To this special Thanksgiving Day service. If you're visiting with us, you're very welcome to join us in our worship this morning. Let me read to you from Psalm 105, and then we'll stand to sing the doxology and remain standing for prayer and our opening hymn, which is number 715. Let's hear the word of God. Oh, give thanks to the Lord, call upon his name, make known his deeds among the peoples. Sing to him, sing praises to him, tell of all his wondrous works. Glory in his holy name. Let the hearts of those who seek the Lord rejoice. Seek the Lord and his strength. Seek his presence continually. Remember the wondrous works that he has done, his miracles and the judgments he uttered, O offspring of Abraham, his servant, children of Jacob, his chosen one. Father, we come to you this morning grateful for all the many mercies you give us, asking that you would be present here with us as we call in your name. We long, Lord, not simply to be together, not simply to sing your praise or hear your word, but to be conscious of your presence and that you, in all your splendor and majesty and yet love and kindness and compassion, have drawn near to us at this time. We pray that you would open our hearts to your love, our minds to your truth, our wills to your obedience, and our whole being to your presence and glory. We ask in Jesus' name. Amen.
seated. Our responsive reading is from Psalm 145, which, if you're using the Church Bible, can be found on page 524. It's a wonderful psalm of thanksgiving, and one that should be read on this day. And I do have a request. Since this is a responsive reading, I'll begin on the odd verse and you on the even, but it ends on an odd verse, and it's a good verse. So why don't we all say it together? So beginning at verse 1. I will extol you, my God and King, and bless your name forever and ever. Every day I will bless you and praise your name forever and ever. Great is the Lord, and greatly to be praised, and his greatness is unsearchable. One generation shall commend your works to another, and shall declare your mighty works. On the glorious splendor of your majesty, and on your wonderful works, wondrous works, I will meditate. They shall speak of the might of your awesome deeds, and I will declare your greatness. They shall pour forth the fame of your abundant goodness, and shall sing aloud of your righteousness.
The Lord is gracious and merciful, slow to anger, and abounding in steadfast love.
The Lord is good to all, and his mercy is over all that he has made. All your works shall give thanks to you, O Lord, and all your saints shall bless you. They shall speak of the glory of your kingdom and tell of your power, to make known to the children of men your mighty deeds and the glorious splendor of your kingdom. Your kingdom is an everlasting kingdom, and your dominion endures throughout all generations. The Lord is faithful in all his words and kind in all his works.
The Lord upholds all who are falling and raises up all who are bowed down.
The eyes of all look to you, and you give them their food in due season. You open your hand, you satisfy the desire of every living thing. The Lord is righteous in all his ways and kind in all his works. The Lord is near to all who call on him, to all who call on him in truth. He fulfills the desire of those who fear him. He also hears their cry and saves them. The Lord preserves all who love him, but all the wicked he will destroy. And together, my mouth will speak the praise of the Lord, and let all flesh bless his holy name forever and ever.
Oh, my soul.
Let's pray together, shall we? Let's all pray. Our Father God, as we draw near to you today, we come as your people. We come to our Father. We come to be reminded as we gather together in this place that this is a place where regularly we come to praise your name and hear your word. It's in this place that we have so often had fellowship with you and felt your presence, and you've been gracious to meet us, and you've been gracious to feed us with your truth. And on this very special day for this country of ours, we come to give you thanks. We come to give you thanks for all the many mercies that you give us in our lives. Just simply as human beings, we are surrounded by so many indications of your generosity and your kindness. Even though in human sin, very often our selfishness and greed misappropriates and misuses many of your good gifts, nonetheless, taken as a whole, looking at the planet we live in, we are surrounded by the beneficence, the sheer magnificence of all your provision. You have made us beautiful things to look at and to wonder at and to see. You have put around us all the indications of the intricacy and depth of your mind and your wisdom and your knowledge. When we look in the telescope, we see the sheer enormity of outer space and the beauty that lies beyond our natural vision. When we look into the microscope, we see how complex and how rich and detailed is the very life of which we are made. When we look at one another, we see the diversity and the beauty and the variety of human beings, and we give you thanks for all that richness that you have made. We thank you for your providence that finds us here in this country, in this continent. And as we reflect on the history of people on this continent, we're grateful that over centuries it was to this land that people who know you, your people, our forebears in the faith, came, leaving persecution, leaving oppression, state oppression, religious oppression, to find a safe place and a secure place in which to raise their families and in which to practice their faith. We thank you, Lord, that for most of the history of this nation, those freedoms have been preserved and protected by the law. We thank you, Lord, that in this nation, the Church of Jesus Christ has grown and has flourished and has been a blessing to other nations around the world. We thank you, Lord, for those who've gone out from this continent to be missionaries and evangelists and pastors and teachers and people in ordinary vocations to work and live in different walks of life and bring the fragrance of the Lord Jesus to the whole world. We thank you, Lord, for people here whose money and generosity have fed and kept the missionary enterprise and the work of Christ around the world. We thank you for the generosity even of our government that keeps people in poorer parts of the world in food and clothing and shelter. And we're grateful, Lord, that we as Christians have had some influence in government policies that have led to that spirit of generosity and charity beyond our shores. We thank you, Lord, for these things. We don't take them for granted. Your word says that we should pray for those who are in power, that we might live peaceable lives and that the gospel might flourish and triumph. And you've been grateful. We're grateful to you that you have answered that prayer in this place. We long that that would continue. We long indeed that, Lord, that you would pour out your spirit on our fellow countrymen and that you would, Lord, revive the cause of God and the kingdom of God here that it would prosper in the days to come. We thank you for your church. We thank you that there is a church in the world, that you've not only created the world, but you have created the church of God, that there is in the midst of the darkness, both the moral and religious darkness of the world, a people called after your name, a people called out of the world, a people called together, a people given your truth, a people with whom you've made a covenant in Christ Jesus, and to whom you've given the covenant document, the Word of God, the Bible, and to whom you have given a high priest, a faithful high priest, who has done all that's required to bring us to you. We thank you, Lord, for that. We thank you that we come to you today, not needing any intermediaries, not needing any religious falderal, not needing any ritual or some other means by which we may come, but we come together as we are now, right into your throne room. And we are heard by you because our Lord Jesus is there. There is a man at your side. There is a man in heaven. The man Christ Jesus, the one mediator between God and man. The one man in whom all the fullness of the deity dwells in bodily form. The one man who has lived righteously and purely and perfectly, not for himself alone, but for his people who are in him. The one man who has taken our sin and carried it to the cross and been wounded for our transgressions and bruised for our iniquities, so that by his poverty we've become rich and by his sufferings we have been brought near into your presence. We thank you for that great salvation. We thank you for the work of the Holy Spirit that takes the Word of God and applies it to us and works with us to change us day by day from glory into glory, becoming more like Jesus. We thank you for your providences. Some of your providences are hard. Some of our loved ones in this congregation and beyond are struggling with your difficult providences. They're going through times of grief, mourning. They're struggling with chronic illness. They're feeling the pang of loneliness. They're struggling with injustice, feeling that they're not heard. We pray today that those who are struggling with the tough providences of life would recognize that behind them, behind the frowning providence, there is a smiling face. But the skies they so much dread are full of mercy and will break in blessing on their head. For those, Lord, who are experiencing the happy providences of life, for those who've been recently married, for those who've recently rejoiced to have children, for those who have been successful in their careers, for those who have found employment, for those, Lord, who are enjoying the good things of life, we praise you. And we pray that as we come to you today, we would be able to weep with those who weep and also rejoice with those who rejoice. We thank you that you're a good God, and we thank you that you're good all the time. We thank you that we can trust in your goodness all the time. And on this great Thanksgiving day, we give thanks to you, the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob, our God, by gracious adoption, because we are in Christ your Son. Hear us, we pray, in his strong name. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning is from Luke chapter 17. If you're using the church Bible, it can be found on page 876. 876, excuse me. Luke chapter 17. Also, following the reading of Scripture, we'll be singing hymn number 714. So we'll be reading verses 11 through 19. On the way to Jerusalem, he, that's Jesus, was passing along between Samaria and Galilee. And as he entered a village, he was met by 10 lepers who stood at a distance and lifted up their voices, saying, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." When he saw them, he said to them, "Go and show yourselves to the priests." And as they went, they were cleansed. Then one of them, when he saw that he was healed, turned back, praising God with a loud voice. And he fell on his face at Jesus' feet, giving him thanks. Now he was a Samaritan. Then Jesus answered, "Were not 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner?" And he said to him, "Rise and go your way. Your faith has made you well." Tremendous. How much we enjoy it, how much it defines all of our lives and actions. And as a result of this grace, our hearts are open to serve others. And we'd ask that you would use these monies to help our partners who work in the city, for those in the Philadelphia Access Center who reach out with hope to many who are caught in a terrible bind. And we pray, too, for the city school that gives hope and education to those in our city who are desiring to learn more and at the same time find the love of Christ. So we pray for your blessing upon these ministries as well as upon us, and ask that you would use these gifts as our thanks to you, for it is in the precious name of Christ that we pray. Amen.
Turn with me in your Bibles to Luke's Gospel, chapter 17, that passage we had read to us earlier that explains to us why it is that the majority of people who are celebrating Thanksgiving this year are going to hell. Does that surprise you? Let's look at the story. The story of this miracle marks a new section of the journey of Jesus to his death. That's the point of the phrase, on the way to Jerusalem. That is going to be the theme of this great section of Luke's gospel. He is heading to Jerusalem to die. And from this point onwards, the main aspect, the main theme of the section will be the last days, that is, the days that are to come. Not just the days that are to come in terms of Jesus dying, but the final days of history. And that theme is introduced by this miracle that we read about, a miracle that stresses the importance of faith and gratitude, and that is immediately followed by a note that says that the kingdom, that is the kingdom of God in Jesus, is in their midst, and Jesus goes on to talk about the end of history as we know it. So the whole emphasis is on God's plan and God's timing. And the main character is, of course, Jesus. He is the star of the story. All the other actors relate in one way or another to him. And so in this story of the 10 lepers, we are introduced to his compassion, we're introduced to his word, and we're introduced to his grace. I want to show you how we come to that conclusion. I want you to notice the compassion of Christ, and a number of factors are interesting. Notice the significance that Luke, who's writing this account, and by the way, Luke at the very beginning has said that he's taken a lot of care to report details that he has checked out. He's a medical man, he's a doctor, he's interested in facts and not in theories, and he's checked out his story with credible eyewitnesses, and so he's able to tell us that precisely geographically where Jesus was. But it's important to the story. He's not merely content to tell us that Jesus was near some village somewhere, but rather he was traveling along the border between Samaria and Galilee. Now, if you were a Jew in Palestine in the first century, Galilee was a kind of suspicious area anyway. Galilee was the place where foreign armies usually came into first. It was kind of northeast, and foreign armies would come down through Galilee, which they often referred to as Galilee of the Gentiles, in order to invade Judah proper. Galilee had a mixed kind of population. There were real Jews there, and it was part of Judaism, but nonetheless, it was held in some suspicion. Samaria, on the other hand, was absolutely not Judaism. It was a foreign nation. It was a nation of mixed race people who had a kind of form of belief that was a distant relative to Judaism. They were regarded as aliens by the Jews, and the Jews had no dealings with the Samaritans. So what you have to understand is that Luke is being quite definitive in telling us where Jesus was. He was in a region whose very geography spelt separation, distance, alienation. And those words, those themes, are caught up in the actual story itself. Because while he was there, we're told, 10 men who were lepers come onto the stage. Leprosy was perhaps the most feared disease in the ancient world, attacking as it did the nerve endings of the body, especially the hands and feet. Victims of leprosy appeared as distorted, almost gruesome figures. They were excluded from normal social settings. They were forced to live outside the boundaries of normal human social interaction. Even when they come into the story, you can see how it's emphasized in verse 12 that they stood at a distance and they lifted up their voices. In other words, they had to shout to be heard. They retained a suitable distance that emphasized the fact that they were outcasts. They were the ultimate outcasts. The law of God, did not allow them to come into the temple. The law of the land didn't allow them to come near healthy people. They were the untouchables. And yet here we're told that these untouchables, these outcasts, came looking for Jesus. Why? What prompted them to come looking for Jesus? And the answer is in their cry, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." Literally, "have compassion on us." They had heard about Jesus. They had heard about the compassion of Jesus. They had come to believe that they could actually make an approach to Jesus, though they did it at a distance. Nonetheless, this is the only time where lepers make an approach to Jesus. They had heard about him. They believed what they'd heard. They come looking for him. They come to the proper distance, and they shout to him, "Jesus, Master, have compassion on us." They'd heard about the compassion of Jesus. What had they heard? They'd heard that Jesus had a habit of reaching out to the untouchables. That Jesus had, in fact, made a habit of doing the unthinkable. He had actually gone and touched the untouchables. He had reached out to them. Normally, you didn't go near them. There was the idea that this was an infectious disease. There was a desperate fear among normal people of catching leprosy, which is why lepers were kept well out the camp and were excluded from the temple. There was also the idea that lepers were unclean spiritually. They were not allowed ceremonially into the temple because of this uncleanness that went with their disease. Jesus had touched them. This is underlined, by the way, or emphasized by the fact that one of these lepers, we're told, was a Samaritan. A Samaritan. If it was bad enough being a leper, it was even worse to be a Samaritan leper. Because to a Jew, a Samaritan was the lowest form of life imaginable. Because they had a bit of the law, they had a bit of the Old Testament as we know it, or the Hebrew Scriptures as we know it. They had the first five books, but not the rest. They didn't believe that God had any purposes for Judah or Jerusalem or the Jewish kingship or anything. They believed what Moses said, but they didn't believe in a Jewish Messiah. And they were the off scouring of the earth as far as the Jews were concerned. This man was doubly unclean. So here were these people. They were untouchable. They were unclean. They were disregarded. And one of them even was a pagan. In fact, Jesus himself uses a word later in the story which we could translate heathen or pagan. These people, in other words, represented physically a spiritual reality. They were socially and religiously excluded from the people of God by virtue of their uncleanness. And throughout Scripture, this becomes a picture, an analogy, if you will, of the spiritual condition of humanity. What these people were ceremonially and physically, everybody, no matter how respectable people are, everybody is regarded by God as being unclean, untouchable, excluded from the company of God by virtue of their sin and rebellion. And here was the remarkable thing. Jesus had touched such people. He had taken on himself, this was the belief, he had taken on himself their uncleanness. And his touch had cured them. He had taken their uncleanness on himself so that they might be clean. And what he'd done physically for lepers, you see, becomes the model of what he had come into the world to do. He is on the way to Jerusalem. He is on the way to the cross. And when he comes to the cross, Jesus becomes unclean. He becomes an untouchable. He becomes a cursed one. He takes the curse, and he takes the curse for all those who are cursed ones, in order that cursed ones might be clean, might be pardoned, might have mercy. When these men come to Jesus and they cry out for mercy, they're crying out for compassion, the compassion that Jesus still shows in the face of stubborn rejection, which he's been doing in the Gospels, in spite of people rejecting him. In fact, in spite of 9 of these people rejecting him in this story, he shows compassion. He shows compassion. He's ready to show it to outsiders. He does it every day. He's ready to bless the ungrateful. He does it every day. The God of the Bible delights to touch those others give up on. The compassion of Jesus. Then the focus shifts to the word of Jesus. When he saw them, verse 14, he said to them, "Go and show yourself to the priest." Now it's interesting that on this occasion, Jesus doesn't touch them. He doesn't reach out to them. On this occasion, he keeps his distance and he merely tells them to do something. He says, "Go and show themselves to the priest." Now, remember that in the ancient times, certainly in Palestine, this was nothing like the United States. There was no separation of church and state. The state was a church and the church was a state. This was a theocracy. And the priests were the top men in that theocracy. The priest was not only a spiritual leader, he was also a physician and a lawyer. So that when Jesus says to these men, "Go and show yourself to the priest," he's saying, "Go and have yourself medically examined. Go and show yourself to the priest. So that the priest can give you a legal writ that declares what your state of health is." What's he asking them to do? He's asking them to go and to believe that in the process of doing what he says, they will be clean when they show up at the priest's door. That's what he's saying to them. I want you to believe my word. I want you to go at my word and go to the priest to get yourself medically examined. And the priest will say whether it's okay for you now to resume normal life, to go back to your golf and go back to your home and go back to your family and go back to your baseball or whatever it is you did before. You're all right, you're cleared of leprosy, you're fine, and you can go home. He was asking these people to believe his word. And you notice that is exactly what happens. Look what it says. As they went, they were cleansed. Here they were hobbling on stumps instead of feet. And as they hobbled along, pulling themselves along with considerable pain and discomfort, as they hobbled along, suddenly those stumps grow digits. And the deformities of their body begin to be ironed out. And by the time they get to the priest's door and the priest looks at them, there they are, and their flesh and their skin is perfect. And their arms and their legs are perfect. And they're totally whole again. Can you imagine? Can you imagine the wonder of that for these people who had been excluded suddenly to come to the priest and the priest look at them and say, "Let me have a look at those hands and those feet. Lift up your arms and so on," and give them a thorough checking out and say, "You're okay. Here you are. Here's your script. You can go back to your village. You're fine. You're well, and you can resume normal operations again." Can you imagine? As they went, they were cleansed. You see, in this story, Jesus is teaching another lesson. The reason he does it this way is to teach us another lesson, that his word is enough. His word is enough. He doesn't need to touch you physically in order to do anything for you. His word is enough. Go, he says. Just like at the beginning, when God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. His word was enough. That's all. That's why when we gather for public worship. The Word of God is the central focus of our worship because that's the point in which God gets the stage. God gets to be heard. And there are two elements in the proclamation of the Word of God. There's a didactic element and a prophetic element. The didactic element is the instruction. We learn things from the Bible. As we open the text, we learn the meaning of the text. That's one thing. But there's a prophetic element. God does something. There's an action involved in the very proclaiming of the Word of God. Wherever God's Word is heard, God's voice is heard. Wherever God's Word is preached, God's voice is heard, and God's power is unleashed. Jesus said to his disciples on one occasion, "You are clean through the word that I've spoken to you." He was taking this cleansing, not just ceremonially, of these men, but he takes this idea of cleansing ceremonially of the leper, and he applies it to the spiritual realm, and he says, "You are clean spiritually by the word. All that has kept you at a distance from God, all that has kept you under the judgment of God and the curse of God and alienated from God, all of that is resolved by my word when you believe my word." So these people act on his word. And the Bible says faith comes by hearing and hearing by the word of God. It says the word of faith is on your lips. You say Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. That's how simple it is to become a Christian. They believed and they went and they were cleansed. No doubt those nine, you notice the divide into nine and one. No doubt they went to the priest, they got the certificate, they went home and they showed off their brand new newly formed skin and limbs. No doubt if they were good Jews, they thanked the God of Israel for their healing. But this story teaches us that that isn't enough. Something new has happened in world history by the coming of Jesus. Having a general attitude of gratitude is not an adequate response for what has happened. In their situation, the miraculous power of God had manifested itself to them in and through Christ. In Christ, to use the language previously found and later to be found in Luke's gospel, the kingdom of God had come upon them. They were expected to respond to God by responding to Jesus. A new day had come, in which the only acceptable response to God is through Jesus. Is through Jesus. How many people in our land today will express general thanksgiving for their family or their health or their job or whatever? Some will be more specific. They will thank a kind of general providence, a kind of general providence that has ordered their lives in such a way that things have come out well for them. How many? And they'll go to hell. Because thanking a general providence isn't good enough. Even thanking God, whatever God is, isn't good enough. It isn't good enough. That's what this whole story is about. This whole story is about these ungrateful nine who represent the popular response to Jesus' mission in the world. They're willing to take his benefits. In Jesus' day, the wine that he made from water, the bread and the fish that fed the multitude, the litany of healings and miracles that brought happiness and joy to families and titillation to the crowds who liked to see the signs and wonders. As the masses came, but they didn't add up the evidence. Despite the miracles done in massive abundance, despite pushing back the frontiers of death and disease in that region over the years of his active ministry, they refused to come to him as their Messiah. He came to his own place, and his own people received him not. Their ingratitude indicates that they couldn't see beyond what was in front of them, couldn't see beyond this age. They had no idea that there was anything beyond their physical need, you see. The healing of the lepers was not an ordinary common gift of the Creator to His creatures, nor was it simply a special gift of God's providence. These men had seen a miracle. These men had seen a sign that was intended to bring them to Christ, so that through Christ they would find salvation. There are many people this Thanksgiving time who will focus on the external gifts that God gives the human race. They'll take what God has to give them. They'll take the charity of the church. They'll take the religious freedom that, to a large degree, in this country, is due to the influence of evangelical Protestant Christianity. They'll take that. But they will not take Jesus. They will not take Jesus. They take God's good gifts, and they join these nine people in this story by taking good gifts and rejecting the giver. Of course, it's even more significant for these men. These men actually had tasted the powers of the age to come. These men are perhaps more like people who sit in churches, who have encountered the supernatural, who have seen firsthand the power of the Word of God changing lives, but who have not been changed themselves, who have never repented themselves, who haven't allowed the Word of God to impact their hearts themselves. But there's another picture in the story, isn't there? There's the grace of Christ. For one of the lepers realizes that he's clean. And his expression of gratitude is the key to the story. He doesn't even go on to the priest. He realizes he is clean. But rather than go and get his certificate of health, he comes back to Jesus in order to give thanks to God. That's the key to the story. It isn't just that he comes back to thank Jesus and then he'll go and thank God. No. It isn't that he thanks Jesus and thanks God. It is, and this is the point of the story, that he comes back to Jesus in order to give thanks to God. He comes back to Jesus because he realizes that to come to Jesus is to give glory to God. To come to Jesus is to give glory to God. And there is no other way to give glory to God. I mean, this man had these two things against him. He was a leper and a Samaritan. That was a double whammy. To be a leper had a social stigma, and a ceremonial stigma. To be a Samaritan brought a religious stigma. But here they are. He comes to Jesus, like many others who would come, non-Jews, unclean people who would come to Jesus and find cleansing. And when he comes back to Jesus, you notice all the distance and alienation between himself and Christ, between himself and God, and between himself and other people is removed. The social, ceremonial, and spiritual separation is all gone. He comes to Jesus, and in his gratitude to God's power in Jesus, he is given a greater gift. He is given the gift of salvation. That's what verse 19 is about. Verse 19 is a different word. It's a word for salvation. He found not only healing, this man gets another gift that goes beyond the material gift or the physical gift of healing. He gets the gift of salvation, forgiveness and reconciliation and eternal life and the removal of all alienation and distance between himself and God caused by sin and moral uncleanness. He throws himself at Jesus' feet. Jesus says to him, "Your faith has made you well. It's given you salvation." Not because he had faith, but because he had faith in Jesus. Jesus is who makes him well. Jesus is not only the healer, he is the Savior. And we come to Jesus and we throw ourselves on him. We, receive that salvation. We cast ourselves on his mercy, and we are saved by him. The gift of salvation. You see, there are only two kinds of people this Thanksgiving, right across this country. There are those who have received blessings in abundance. Those who, like the lepers, have come near to Christ, but they've not come to Christ. With the nine lepers, the kingdom of God has come within their reach. Here, people in this country are without excuse, aren't they? They're without excuse. There are other countries in the world that don't hear the gospel, but in this country, people hear the gospel. It is available to them on the radio, on television, on their street corner. They can hear the gospel. But they have not come to Christ. These men in their leprosy had come near Jesus. And they'd received what Jesus had to give them. It was a great blessing. But they'd walked away, and they walk off the page of Holy Scripture. And as far as we know, they walk off the stage into hell. There's no record of them ever finding Jesus. No record of them ever finding salvation. You see, all God's good gifts are meant to lead us to the one person who is the supreme gift to humanity. It's the height of foolishness to think that we can take the gifts and ignore the giver. On this Thanksgiving, it is not enough to thank some vague providence for good things in life. Not enough to ascribe the benefits we enjoy in this country because of our Christian heritage to other factors and suppress the recognition of the reality. We must come to Christ. For Thanksgiving to have any ultimate eternal value, 10 billion years from today, it must be the thanksgiving that is offered to God through Jesus. There is no other name by which we must be saved, God says. The only thanksgiving that God hears is that that comes to him in Jesus' name. Perhaps for the first time this morning, you, like this Samaritan, former leper, will come to Christ and find a greater gift than even physical healing would be, because you will find Jesus. Let's pray. Father, we ask that on this special and wonderful day, when families will come together all across the country to be together and enjoy each other's company, that more and more people in this nation would come to your Son and through him come to you and find fullness of life. In his name we pray. Amen.
Thank you.
may grace, mercy, and peace from God, the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit rest and remain with you now and evermore. Amen. God be with you.